Okay, Gorm. It is 11 o'clock, and session continues now. It states I haven't received any questions yet in the feed. We'll probably get to that later, and obviously one of my questions for you to think about when you do more presentation now is, when is the optimum time for the cross discipline decision to actually do multilateral discussions? So with that, I give the word back to you. Du muta. Om du fremdeles muta. Linn, kan du släppa den igenom eller?
Där skulle bli bättre då.
Nå er det bedre.
Ja, ok. Ok, thank you very much, Gerard. I heard your question, and it's one of the questions that I'm actually getting back to. And of course, in my world, it's as early as possible. But I'll show you a little bit about how I think about it and how I think it should be done. We have been through all this above the break till now, and now we're going to talk a little bit about field development alternatives. I have got the benefit of looking into the Duva field together with one of the engineers working for Gerhard in Neptune, making models of the fields and done some brainstorming with them. What I'd like to do now is just show you a quick movie. I'll talk a little bit through it and show what could have been done. And after that, I would like to show you how I think this should be, the MLT should be included in the early plans, and what kind of a team and how you could set that planning up.
And then just as a disclaimer, I can tell everybody that I have not given GOM access to all the completion engineers and all the drilling engineers. So this is a, it's not a fantasy product, but it's a good steer to different thinking for our Duva development.
I appreciate that, Gerard. Thanks. So this shows a little bit about Duva, and the first slides that you see here, of course, it's this is heaven. And when you get down in the bottom here, you see the heaven again. That's fancy. I like that. But anyhow, these are the wells that's planned on Duva. And here you've got one gas well, and you've got three oil wells. The horizontal sections of the K2 and K4, I don't really know which is which of these two, but it doesn't really matter. It's about 1,200 meters long on both of them. This well is probably also a horizontal, but I haven't got all the data in the bottom, and it's about to be, it's drilled down to this section right now, as I understand. Oh, yeah. Shouldn't start here again. So what we're doing now, we've been working a little bit on this field to see what we could have done, and we have to anticipate where the reservoirs are. In a real world, you would know exactly where to go and how you could actually work out on these laterals and what you actually like to drain. In our case, we did some anticipations and we just put them out here. And frankly, we were three people working on this for quite a while, and we tossed the files forth and back, and we spent about 3 weeks to do it all. Of course, not full time, but this time stretch of doing this was too long. But anyhow, I can't stop this and continue it, but for some reason, I'll just run the rest of it from here. So what we did was adding the laterals to this first well, and we did the same to the second well. They let the gas producer stay like it was, and we actually just increased the put this trilateral out in the area where it looked like it should be productible. I would say that this project like this should, the additional cost for these wells altogether should be less than or about the same as another half well budget. And of course, it's three laterals and not three additional laterals, and the length of them could be about the same as the full blown project. As the single bore wells. So yeah, if this is a picture of another project that we looked into 5 to 10 years back, I had to pull it out of some of my old slides. And there we had a lot of targets, and I just where we had planned wells already. And this conservative approach is what you see on the left side here. And you don't, of course, you don't save any money on that. You do use your budget on drilling. If we do the adaptive approach, which is in average, it's a dual MLT on all wells. So you have reduced the well bores to 20 instead of 40. Then you, on this specific project, save about 35% on your drilling and well cost. If you go for the integrator where you really use MLT, that's what I would call getting through the paradigm shift. Then you could reduce the total field development cost with up to 50%. And this is the message I'm trying to get. This is the message I'm trying to get across when we're talking about multilaterals. When it comes to an evaluation session like we did here, this is one of my very last slides. For the Duva project, I would as soon as I had the single well project up going, like this one, or just four wells, of course, I would gather together this team, and I could do it all on Teams and with the Informatik that made this slide for us. It was very simple to change the reservoir sections with the well planner on board. But of course, we were only these three people, but if we pulled in a drilling engineer, a reservoir engineer, and a completion engineer, we would have all the answers on the spot, and all of this could have been done on Teams, just as we are discussing doing this webcast right now. But of course, what you need is, I have just mentioned a lot of things that could be required, but of course, as much as possible information on the fingertips. And then you could do a brainstorming and find an alternative plan for your field development at a very early stage. And you could have a good idea of the economics as well. What is important to do an assessment like this is to have good trust. You need to be able to pull in your other service companies, which I've started to write down here, and you need somebody, an MLT engineer, with experience of how things are happening, besides your drilling team and the reservoir team that you already have available in your group. So that actually ends my presentation today, and I would be very happy to discuss this last issue further. I think it's important to do it earlier, and I'm open for opening myself for questions. So thank you very much for your attention so far. I hope that somebody has some further questions that you want us to discuss further on.
Well, I guess the first question is for Lynn, because the first question is where will we put this recorded session? And I guess that will be in the Force Network. Lynn, I don't know if you're still with us.
I am here. The recording will be public on force.org, so under events and available presentations.
That's good, and I'll send the slide deck as well, not totally as it is today, but with a little bit more explanations and a little bit of simplifications for you. So you can spread that as well.
Very good.
Thank you.
There was a question from Camilo on HPHT applications. Can you comment on that?
HPHT doesn't say much about what high pressure and high temperature is, but if we talk about 15K equipment, we're not there. But another thing, but we are developing systems in around a 9F518 system right now, which is good for close to 10K. And that's about the limit that you can get with ID access that we need for this junction to do fracking operations. When it comes to temperature, that's just picking the right seal. So I don't see that as a big challenge. But saying all of this, you have to recall that the MLT junction is normally below your completion packer. And that means that you have your barriers above yourself, which again means that your junction doesn't necessarily see anything else than the depletion of one of the reservoirs in case the other side of it is shut in because it's shut in early. So you don't necessarily need a full pressure, high pressure junction, even though it's a high pressure field. Of course, if it's a fracking application, the picture is different.
Thank you. Moving on to the next question. How do you evaluate the current technologies on the MLT? Somebody is working on a retrofit MLT concept, and what are your thoughts around this concept?
Retrofit is not a common word in MLT, but I would say that the extreme grip MLT system, as I showed you on one of my first MLT cases, is a retrofit MLT system. That's something that we run and we tie it back to the top to an old line hanger, for instance, and we use that as a reference point. We just don't run the full screen section below, so it's a retrofit system.
And from Bjorn Mysen here, blowout and kill studies, any consideration regarding this and the increased flow from MLT wells?
Yeah, sure. Well, definitely. Normally an MLT system or most of the MLT systems that has been drilled in the past has been with 12.25 inch drilled out into the reservoir to set 9.58 or 10.75 to sidetrack from. In some cases, you can't do that with using a single, call it, relief well, with a single relief well, which I understand is demand from Petil today. So then you need to go into smaller sizes, and you could probably use systems like the Adventure expandable line hanger, as I just mentioned, that we're using on Troll to get the 9.58 inch in a smaller hole, or you need to sidetrack above the reservoir. Sidetracking above the reservoir is not the same challenge as it used to be, because it's higher pressure junctions that we are using today. For instance, the junction most common on Alvheim, which is about 3,500 PSI junction, which is suitable for that kind of applications.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And I guess you asked Eriksson not to ask this question. What is the argument for not using MLT?
I love the question. I would say there could be, not every application is suitable for multilaterals. Some fields, or so in some areas, it's high pressure, it's difficult, you have a challenging main board to install, and you don't really want to go ahead and risk that by drilling another high pressure section in the same well with the current technology available. Remember that what we're doing we drill a multilateral well is that first we complete the main bore section and it's all finished. Only thing you have to do to start producing is to run the top completion. And you start doing the dumbest thing that you ever do. You mill a hole in the casing and you start doing it over again. It seems stupid, but it pays off. So you have to evaluate that payoff thoroughly, or at least take a look at it and look at the experience and go ahead. And that's what both Equinor and Aker BP is doing, and they find it viable every time, as far as I can see.
Okay, we've got a question on unconsolidated reservoirs. What's the limitations when it comes to unconsolidated reservoirs, and is there a high distance between laterals? Will that help? I guess it's to your screens and your... Yeah.
Is it, then I have to ask back, is it unconsolidated so that you can't really get your screens in quick enough so that it drops in the drilling phase? Or what is the challenge? Is the challenge that... it depends what the challenge actually is.
Sharam, would you like to comment? I think we've lost wellbore stability is...
Wellbore stability is essential. The liner deployment system that I showed you earlier was developed specifically, I believe it was for Grane, actually to get around the unstable formations so that you could, after you drill the section, you could go in and complete it right away. You didn't have to wait for pulling the whipstock and running a reflector and then go out, but you could complete it right away and could retrieve the whipstock afterwards and then just tie back to it. So it was only a short section that was kept open. So if that was the case, yes, we're getting around it. If that was the question, I mean, sorry.
Yeah, it sounded like that was the question. So next question is it correct to speculate that MLTs are more suitable for oil wells rather than condensate wells?
I wouldn't say so. Oil wells has been the easiest way to start, but it's all depending on the pressure rating and what you can handle. But most of the wells that we've had, mostly all, I would say, the wells that we have completed till today, which is 360 plus, is oil wells, with one exception, which is was the water injector that I mentioned for on Fram. So yes, maybe, but I would rather say that it's just because we haven't tried it for the condensate wells. There's no reason why it shouldn't work just as well there.
Then I got a rather expansive question from Bohemir Svetkovic on the topics related to MLT trajectory coordinates for modeling design, MLT and multi-fracking, and MLT simulation challenges. It's not really a question, it's three big topics. So I think that we will... are there any... specific simulation challenges with the multilaterals gone?
Production-wise, as I'm coming from the service side, we don't get too much production information. It is, of course, more challenging to simulate an MLT well compared to a production well. And I don't think we are good enough at doing that. But at the other hand, every single customer I've talked to that's done a multilateral and have installed equipment already hence time if you ask them, and specifically when I have challenges during installation time. If you ask them afterwards if it was a better economy in the project, no, then it would have been drilling through wells. When they're looking back at the production as well, I have never got the reply that we would rather drill two wells. I think that answers the question.
No, I don't. But I think that it's a good answer from you. And I think that we can say from your side that we are quite able to simulate the MLT responses, as you said, on reservoir length. So don't see any particular challenges there. And I hope that none of our reservoir engineers are listening to this. Multi-fracking is another topic. That's both difficult and time-consuming to do multi-fracking in MLT.
I tried to explain that a bit earlier, that fracking is a challenge, yes. What we typically would do, or what we are doing just on ConocoPhillips right now, is a well where we go in and we do the fracking job with... I think so. I'm not lying here. Fracking is a challenge. It needs to be worked thoroughly. What I should rather say instead of going into the details that I don't really know. But it is being done and is being evaluated for quite a few fields, and we will definitely get back with a better way of doing that. I mentioned alternatives to fracking, like fish bones and so forth. So it's just getting into the communication earlier and start working on it. And I'm sure we would typically find the solution, but I don't have it presentable here now, unfortunately.
Okay. Can I make only comments, please?
Yes.
Okay. First of all, I work in Copenhagen, in Maersk Oil, and then we have several fields where we have 40 multi-fractured horizontals. So my question was really why I am not making one multilateral and put these fractures along them. So is this technology is ready, or it may be ready one day? What do you think?
I think that to get the kind of information you're asking for there, it's difficult for me to sit in a webinar and answer to that. So I would presume that what you're looking for is available, but I would be happy if you took contact with me and share my name and email address in the bottom of the
slide. I will be very much appreciated, because we also did, when I was in Schlumberger, was a base in Oxford, we made 400 lateral simulation multilaterals. In that time, technology was ready for drilling, but not for modeling.
Yep.
And making gridding, multi-gridding, that means it took too much time. So that was the challenges. I will appreciate talking to you later. Thank you very much. Appreciated your presentation. Excellent work. Thanks.
I appreciate that. I had a little comment there. When we are... quite a few fields that we have been looking into, and we're looking into them at an early stage, do not anticipate enough faults in the reservoir, so that the simulations are frequently too good for horizontal flow, and therefore hence time many operators that I've been talking to say that they should have had more faults in the reservoir, or just simulated it like that, and thereby they would have gone with some way of improved communication between the reservoirs, and multilaterals would have been one of the things that they should have studied closer at an early time.
Okay.
I just wanted to say that I was at IFE Scheller, and we made a simulator with Viggo Holm from Phillips Petroleum Company, and Conoco and BP financed that for 400 fractures, and it was easy to extend it. It was in my plan to make for multilaterals. So just for you to know that IFE was active in 2001, it was industry best standard. Howif was the name. Okay, thank you, guys. Bye.
Thank you. So now we have three more questions coming in, and we'll draw the line there. So I'll start with Björn Musen's question on moving from horizontal Christmas trees to vertical Christmas trees. Are we moving in the wrong direction for possible later multilateral work? What do you say to that, Gorm?
Good, very good question. I can't really elaborate around that. Of course, if you're losing access or possible access in the future to your wells, yes, you're moving in the wrong direction. And that's about it. But you'd like to have access and be able to go back in and work in your wells at a later stage. And there are a few things you can do to your standard wells and subsea wells that increases the possibility of doing infill wells at a later stage, such as setting your main bore liner a bit deeper, having a horizontal Christmas tree, and so forth. But normally we don't think 5 years down the road, and therefore we take a shortcut and we make the cheapest solution at the present moment.
Okay, and then we've got a question from Beata. If multilateral junctions above the reservoir having risk of fine production hole collapse as reservoir pressure is depleting, is it possible to have an enclosed junction, not pressure sealed, to avoid hole collapse when access to main bore is important for the interventions?
That was a few questions in the same, in one go, I guess. I need to see a sketch on that to answer thoroughly, but I would presume that what she's asking is something we could work on.
So, Bart, you can talk to Gorm later. But Svein has the last question. Anyone thinking about combining water injection and lower lateral oil production from an upper lateral or periodic water injection oil production in mature fields, even if it's not an initial field development scope?
We have got a lot of questions like that. It sounds like a great dream, and to me it is a great dream. And the main reason why I don't love it, I think I mentioned this in my presentation as well, is that normally on an oil producer, we like to use 13% chrome or some kind of an exotic material. That doesn't really fit in with the water injector, where we typically use carbon steel. And those two together, those challenges together are tricky enough. And in addition to that, when you have a water injector, that's cold fluids, and the fluids that you are producing are hot, so you get the tube move challenge as well. So I don't foresee that being a way of doing MLTs in the future. But saying that, WAG wells, for instance, where you do one thing at a time, is feasible. So I have a bigger belief in that, actually.
Okay, we'll let that be the final word. And thank you, Gorm, for an excellent presentation and good answers to a lot of questions. And thank you all, audience, for staying with us and contributing to a really interesting closing of this presentation. Have a good Wednesday, all, and we'll see you at the next webinar.
Thank you very much, Gerhard. It was a pleasure to be here.